Okay, the third thing I want to look at now is called the Treasury Stock Method. So with the Treasury Stock Method, this deals with options, rights, warrants. So this is like a stock option. Let's think about a stock option. If you had a stock option, what happens? Options, warrants, you have these things that allow you to convert it, give money, and get common stock back. So if you think about it, what are you giving me? You're giving me money. What am I giving you? Common stock. So whether it's an option, whether it's a right, whether it's a warrant, I've got to look at that and use what we call the Treasury Stock Method. Now, listen carefully. This is what we're doing theoretically. Again, you may never even exercise the option, right, or warrant. But theoretically, what is earnings per share? Theoretically speaking, if we distribute all our money, how much would you get per share? So here's what happens. If you gave me a stock option, what happens? You'd exercise the option, give me some money. I would then give you stock. But I want to minimize the dilutive effect. So here's what I do. I go out in the open market and I buy back my own stock. What's that called? Treasury stock. Then minimizing the dilutive effect. So if I gave you 4 shares, but you're going to give me less money than market price, right? Because otherwise you wouldn't exercise it. It would be anti-dilutive. I then take the money, go out and buy it back at the average market price. Therefore, that would be the difference. So really, I would just look at the incremental difference. So if you gave me money and I spent it all, how much money do I have left to give away? If I took all the money and I gave it away, then I would have nothing left. So I would have 0 money left. But in the denominator, I would add in something called plus the incremental number of common stock outstanding at the average market price. That's what I would have to add back, the incremental number of shares outstanding at the average market price. And the average market price means on average, how much was the stock trading for during that year? That's what average market price is. So let's say, for example, I had 40,000 options. And let's say they were convertible into 40,000 shares of common stock. So you can convert those into 40,000 shares of common stock. Now, you're going to give me $15 a share as the option price. You're going to give me $600,000. Cool. But you gave me $600,000, but let's say the average market price is $20 a share. That means I could only buy back 30,000 shares of Treasury stock. That means that you gave me $600,000. I theoretically took the money, went out and bought back my stock at $20 a share. Now notice, is it dilutive? Yeah, because the option price is 15 and the market price is 20. Would you give me 15 if I gave you 20? Yes. Would you give me 20 if I gave you 15? No, that's anti-dilutive. So what we're doing is you theoretically give me 15, I then give you 40,000 shares of stock. I go out on the average market and I buy back, theoretically, I spend all 600,000. So when I spend it all, how much money's left? Zero. So I have zero to add in the numerator. However, I'm gonna take that, go out and buy back, how much? 30,000 shares. What is the incremental number of shares outstanding? 10,000. So what it theoretically means is you gave me 600, I spent 600, zero left. I had 40,000 I gave you, I bought back 30. What's the incremental change? 10,000. So if you add nothing in the top and 10,000 in the bottom, obviously what does that do to everyone's earnings per share? It drops it, it dilutes it. So that's what we're looking at. So that is called the Treasury stock. So number three here is gonna be the Treasury stock method. And the Treasury stock method, that is for options, rights, and warrants. Now remember warrants, we had bonds with detachable, preferred stock with detachable, we have stock options going to whom? Employees. We have rights going to whom? Stockholders. These allow people. So what do? We include them. And again, it doesn't matter if you really converted. Why? Could you convert? Yes. Is it advantageous economically? Yes. Then we assume you did, whether you really did or not. That's how it fits in. That's called the Treasury stock method. I understand that it's confusing, but let's do it again. You have 40,000 options. If you exercise them, you're going to give me 15 bucks a share. As long as the market price is more than 15, it's dilutive, we have to include it. So what do we say? If you exercised them, you would have given me 600,000. I would have given you 40,000 shares of common stock. I would then theoretically take the money, theoretically go out and buy back my stock at how much? The average common stock market price. I go out and buy back only 30,000, incremental number. In the top, zero. In the bottom, I would add in 10,000, which is this. And that would obviously do what to earnings per share? It would decrease everybody's earnings per share. That is considered to be dilutive. All right? So that is what you're doing. You're going to make that change today. So that is called the Treasury Stock Method, and it's an important concept to understand. Does that one doesn't get as tested as much. But let's kind of look at the big picture again. What have we learned so far? We start out here with basic. What is basic? Simple. It says there's no potentially dilutive securities. You have net income minus preferred dividends. Preferred dividends, if they are cumulative, whether declared or not. If they're non-cumulative, only if declared. You divide that by the weighted average number of common stock outstanding. Weighted average number of common stock is calculated how? Over here. We're going to say dividends and splits are treated retroactively. You take your numbers and you weight them. How much of the year were they outstanding? That's called weighted average. This whole year, this three quarters of the year, this retroactive, this treasury stock came out of here, so it's how much they weren't outstanding. Two for one split hits everything. Plus anything retroactive goes back to all the previous years also presented. Okay, so we take our net income minus preferred is the dollars divided by that. You then take this number, bring it over, and adjust it by two. Numbers. You take this, bring it over, adjust it by two. The first adjustment is called the if converted method. The if converted method is for convertible bonds, convertible preferred stock. What does it say? It says if you convert, what would happen? If it's preferred, you wouldn't have to pay it, add it back in, not net of tax. If it's bonds, add it back in, net of tax. In the denominator, add in the number of common stock shares that it was converted into, and usually they will tell you that or you have to calculate it, but it tells you the preferred converted to this, the bonds converted to that. Then in the denominator, the denominator, number of shares. The third method is called the treasury stock method for options, rights, and warrants. What it says is theoretically, if you exercised your option, right, or warrant, you give me money. What do? I give you stock. Then, I want to minimize the dilutive effect, so I gave you 40,000 shares, but I'm going to then take that theoretical money, go out and buy back stock at the average market price. Then I'm going to buy fewer shares, so if I spent all the money, I've got zero left. What's left is the incremental number, which is 10,000 plus incremental number of common stock outstanding at average market price. Divide that. That's how you get your diluted earnings per share. So again, it was called basic. It's called diluted. Those are the two different things we're going to have to look at. Those are required to be shown where? On the face of your income statement. So where? For income from continuing and from net income. And the DE, discontinued, disposal, and extraordinary. You can show either for the both as well in the face or also in the footnotes. Okay? So that's an important concept. This goes hand in hand with stockholders' equity because they'll take net income, they need to calculate your shares outstanding, and that's kind of where it gets tested. I like to break it apart separately so we can kind of walk through little baby step through accounting. That's how we get through it, that's how we learn, that's how we live it, love it, learn it. Okay? In a couple of minutes, we'll apply all of this and we'll do some questions.